Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar Ayyasakarni. The news articles along with the page numbers are displayed here for your reference. The PDF link of the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles is given in the description box as well as in the comment section. Now let us start our today's news analysis. This news article is about the fire accident that has happened in New Delhi. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. Yesterday, that is on 8th December, a major fire accident has happened in the residential building in the central Delhi. Though the fire accident has happened in the residential building, but a major portion of this residential building was rented out as a jacket manufacturing unit. So we can say that the manufacturing unit has been operating illegally in the residential building, and the major cause of the fire could be short circuit in this case. So as per this news article, 4 people died because of burn injuries and others died due to suffocation, that is asphyxiation. Here asphyxiation means the state of being deprived of oxygen, and if there is a very less or no oxygen, then a person will become unconscious and could lead to death because of shortage of oxygen. And the main reason for such huge casualties is that there was no ventilation in the building because of narrow staircases and windows with grills and a locked terrace. In addition, the factory's raw material was stored inside, and majority of them were combustible material such as cardboard, resin, plastic and other packing materials. So when fire broke out, the burning of raw materials resulted in dense smoke and the entire building became as a gas chamber. So the workers were not able to escape and they died due to asphyxiation. So in this context of this news article, let us know some facts on the poor status of fire safety in India. See, fire service is a state subject and has been included as municipal function in the schedule of the constitution. And the municipal corporations and the local bodies are responsible for providing fire services in many states. So there is no uniform law for fire safety in the country. And this is a major drawback leading to poor fire safety in India. There is the National Building Code of 2016 guidelines, and this deals with fire safety, and this covers the detailed guidelines for construction, maintenance and fire safety of the structures, like a number of exits, then the place of extinguishers and use of fire retardant building materials enforce fire safety. And these guidelines were published by Bureau of Indian Standards, and it is used by the local bodies for framing building laws. But the issue is that it is just a recommendary guidelines but not mandatory. So often the safety measures are overlooked, leading to non-implementation of fire safety measures in India. If you look at the records of National Crime Records Bureau, that is in 2015 alone, a total of 18,450 cases of fire accidents were reported in India, and about 17,700 people were killed. This means that roughly more than 48 people are killed in India due to fire accidents in every day. Among these, almost about 42.1% of deaths were due to fire accidents in residential buildings. The data also tells that the maximum number of fire accidents were reported in urbanized states like Maharashtra, Gujarat, then Madhya Pradesh, then Tamil Nadu. This shows that the close relation between high population densities in urban areas and then lack of urban planning and presence of such illegal manufacturing units in the residential areas. So from the above discussion, we can say that the central and state governments have to take concrete measures to prevent such fire accidents, which are becoming regular in the recent times. So this is the information with respect to this news article. Now let us move on to the next news article. This news article is about the Lokpal and its present status of implementation of Lokpal and Lokayuktas Act of 2013. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. So in this context, we'll be discussing about Lokpal, which is established under the Lokpal and the Lokayuktas Act of 2013, then the composition of Lokpal and the present status of the Lokpal Act implementation. See, the main function of Lokpal is to inquire and investigate into the allegations of the corruption cases against the public functionaries who are falling within the ambit of this Act of 2013. Now, if you look at the composition of the Lokpal, which consists of a chairperson and the members who shall not be more than 8 in number, then out of the total members of this Lokpal, 50% of the members shall be from judicial members. then out of the total members of this Lokpal, 50% of the members shall be judicial members. Then the remaining 50% is the non-judicial members. So if you consider Lokpal as a whole, we can tell that Lokpal consists of chairperson, then the 4 judicial members, then 4 non-judicial members. About 50% of the non-judicial members shall be from the persons belonging to the scheduled caste, then the scheduled tribes, then other backward classes, including minorities and women. Now, we'll see about the appointment of Lokpal members and its chairperson. And they are appointed by the president on the recommendations of a selection committee. And this selection committee consists of 5 members, including its chairperson. Know that Prime Minister is the chairperson of this selection committee. Then other members includes the Speaker of Lok Sabha, then the Leader of Opposition in the Lok Sabha, then the Chief Justice of India or a judge of a Supreme Court nominated by the Chief Justice of India. And this selection committee also consists of 1 eminent jurist. So we can say this selection committee consists of 5 members including its chairperson. Now we'll discuss about the powers and authority of Lokpal. The Lokpal has power to inquire into allegations of corruption cases against the public functionaries who are or who have been in the office. For example, it can include the Prime Minister, then the Minister in the Union Government, then the Member of Parliaments, as well as officials of the Union Government under the categories of Group A, Group B, Group C and then Group D. Then the Lokpal has also have authority to inquire into allegations of corruption charges against the chairpersons or members or officers, even the directors of any board or corporation or society or trust or any autonomous body, either which is established by an act of parliament or partly funded by the union or the state governments, will come under the ambit of Lokpal. Know that Lokpal also covers any society or trust or body that receives foreign contributions above 10 lakh rupees. Now, we'll see the present status of implementation of the provisions of this Lokpal Act of 2013. And this act was passed in 2013. And the present first chairperson and the members of Lokpal were appointed in the month of March 2019 only. Therefore, at present, there is a chairperson and then 4 judicial persons and also 4 non-judicial members of this Lokpal. Now, if you look at the news article, it says that several key provisions of Lokpal and Lokayuktas Act of 2013 have not been operationalized. This assumes significance because Lokpal has said that the process of constituting the Lokpal's inquiry and prosecution wings have not yet begun. Know that as per sections 11 and 12 of this act, Lokpal shall constitute an inquiry wing and prosecution wing respectively. Until the time these wings are constituted, the central government shall provide necessary personnel for conducting inquiries and prosecution as per this act. However, such action has not been initiated by the Lokpal. The news article also tells that the regulations for how to conduct preliminary investigations have not been finalized. If you see section 60 of the act, it gives the Lokpal the power to make regulations on many matters. And one such matter is regarding the power of Lokpal to make regulations on the manner and the procedure of conducting preliminary inquiry or investigation. Then the one more additional matter is that regarding the power of Lokpal to make regulations on the website to display of the status of all complaints in terms of whether the complaint is pending or disposed along with the records and the evidences. But till now, rules and regulations have not been made on both these matters so far. The news article also tells that Lokpal has not yet notified a format for filing complaints. Despite this, about 1065 complaints were sent to the office of Lokpal. And out of this 1065 complaints, around 1000 complaints have been disposed of until September 30th. Now, we'll see about the disclosure of assets and liabilities by the public servants. Know that as per the section 44 of Lokpal and Lokayuktas Act of 2013, every public servant shall make a declaration of his assets and liabilities. The news article also tells that the rules for the disclosure of assets and liabilities by the public servants have not been notified either. And this is a key provision of this act because often the source of complaint is that assets are acquired by the public servant disproportionate to to the known sources of their income. So we can say that Lokpal and Lokayuktas Act of 2013 has to be implemented in full spirit to ensure the government's commitment to clean and responsive governance. And Lokpal is one such body to curtail and punish acts of corruption committed by the public functionaries. So in this context of this news article, also know that India has ratified the United Nations Convention Against Corruption in 2011. And this convention is the only legally binding universal anti-corruption instrument. Therefore, to summarize this news article, we have seen some of the important provisions of Lokpal and Lokayuktas Act of 2013, and then about the news article, which tells that several key provisions of this act have not been operationalized. Now, have a look at the practice question, which will be discussed at the end of the session. Now, let us move on to the next news article. This news article is related to the Citizenship Amendment Bill of 2019. And as per the news article, this contentious bill will be introduced in the Lok Sabha by the Union Minister on 9th December, that is on today. And this bill has been in the news for the last few months. The important provisions of the bill and the objections raised against the bill were discussed in detail in our 5th December 2019 news analysis video, and it is advisable to watch it for the better understanding of the Citizenship Amendment Bill of 2019. But in our today's analysis, we'll be discussing in detail about the constitutional provisions related to the citizenship. Know that Part 2 of the Constitution of India, that is the articles from 5 to 11, deals with citizenship. But the Constitution contains neither any permanent nor any elaborate provisions in this regard. And these articles, that is articles from 5 to 11, only identify the persons who became citizens of India at the commencement of the Constitution, that is on 26th January 1950. It does not deal with the problem of acquisition or loss of citizenship after 26th January 1950. But the Constitution empowers the Parliament to enact a law to provide for such matters and any other matter relating to the citizenship. Therefore, the Parliament has enacted the Citizenship Act of 1955, and it has been amended from time to time. And the present 2019 bill also tries to amend this Act of Citizenship of 1955. So, in today's analysis, we'll be discussing the constitutional provisions with respect to citizenship. As per the Constitution of India, there are four categories of persons who became the citizens of India at the commencement of the Constitution. Article 5 says that any person who had his domicile in India and also fulfilled any one of the three conditions, that is, if he was born in India, or if either of his parents was born in India, or if he has been ordinarily resident in India for 5 years immediately before the commencement of the Constitution, became a citizen of India. Now look at the Article 6. It says that the rights of citizenship of certain persons who have migrated to India from Pakistan. Article 6 says that a person who migrated to India from Pakistan became an Indian citizen if he or either of his parents or any of his grandparents was born in undivided India and also fulfilled any one of the two conditions, that is, in case if he migrated to India before 19th July 1948 and he had been ordinarily resident in India since the date of his migration, or in other case, that is, if he migrated to India on or after 19th July 1948 and he had been registered as a citizen of India. And this has to be done by an officer appointed by the Government of India on an application made by the person seeking the registration to such officer before the commencement of this Constitution. But a person could be so registered only if he had been resident in India for 6 months preceding the date of his application for the said registration. Now look at the Article 7 provisions, which deals with the rights of citizenship of certain migrants to Pakistan. It says that a person who migrated to Pakistan from India after 1st March of 1947 but later returned to India for resettlement could become an Indian citizen. So for this, he had to be resident in India for 6 months preceding the date of his application for registration. Then Article 8 deals with the rights of citizenship of certain persons of Indian origin residing outside India. It says that a person who or any of whose parents or grandparents was born in undivided India, but who is ordinarily residing outside India shall become an Indian citizen if he has been registered as a citizen of India by the diplomatic or consular representative of India in the country of his residence. So, therefore, Article 8 deals with overseas Indians who may want to acquire Indian citizenship. Now, let us discuss about Article 9, which says that no person shall be a citizen of India or be deemed to be citizen of India if has voluntarily acquired the citizenship of any foreign state. Then Article 10 says that every person who is or is deemed to be a citizen of India shall continue to be such citizen subjected to the provisions of any law made by the Parliament. Look at Article 11, which says that Parliament shall have the power to make any provision with respect to the acquisition and termination of citizenship and all other matters relating to citizenship. Therefore, this constitutional power was used by the Parliament to make the Citizenship Act of 1955. And also, the present, that is 2019 Citizenship Amendment Bill, is also based on this power, which is enshrined in Article 11. Know that Citizenship Act of 1955 provides for acquisition and loss of citizenship after the commencement of the Constitution of India. It prescribes 5 ways of acquiring citizenship, that is, by birth or by descent or by registration or by naturalization or by incorporation of territory. From this, what we need to understand is that none of these provisions enables a person to acquire or loss of citizenship based on their religion. That is why the proposed Citizenship Amendment Bill of 2019 has become one of the most contentious bill, because it proposes that the persons belonging to minority communities like Hindus, Sikhs, or Buddhists, or Jains, or Parsis, and Christians from the countries like Afghanistan, Bangladesh, and Pakistan shall not be treated as illegal migrants and can be eligible to get the citizenship of India. So, in this direction, the Union Home Minister is going to introduce the proposed Citizenship Amendment Bill of 2019 in the Lok Sabha. And once it is tabled in the Lok Sabha, we could able to know the exact provisions in the proposed Amendment Bill of 2019. With this, we have come to the end of the analysis of this news article, and the displayed practice question will be discussed at the end of the session. Now, let us proceed to the next news article. This news article is titled as An Asian Engine Driven by India and China. In this editorial, the author discusses some of the concerns between both the countries, that is, between India and China. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. The author mentions that the global engines of economic growth have shifted to Asia in the last 30 years. Initially, the engines were in the hands of powerful countries in the Asia-Pacific region. But now, the engines have shifted to the Indo-Pacific region, that includes South Asia. In fact, the Asian continent, which has around half the global population, has emerged as the new fulcrum of geo-economic and geostrategic realignments. Here, fulcrum refers to the point that keeps the geostrategic and geo-economic alignments as a balanced as well as ensures the order. And this region is known for high economic growth rates. But at the same time, the region is also accompanied by some of the highest military expenditures in the world. This means that while the region has enough potential to show higher growth rates, the region is also suffering from political or border security issues. That is why the author mentions that the region is also known for some of the highest military expenditures in the world. Then the article mentions that both India and China are expected to contribute global economic growth in the future. So the expectation is that the Asian engine of economic growth will be driven by India and China. But both the nations have some concerns that they have to take into serious consideration. Then the author mentions that China is the world's second largest economy, and China must play a constructive role globally and also within the Asia. But how is China playing within Asia in terms of trade? Let us take the bilateral trade between India and China. And India faces a huge and rising trade imbalance against China. If you see financial year 2018-19, the bilateral trade between two countries stands at about $87 billion, But the share of India is just about $17 billion. This means that trade deficit that India has with China is around $53 billion. So in this context, the author mentions that the recent decision made at the Mahamallapuram summit, that is in the month of October 2019, is significant. This is because it was agreed between the two countries to set up a new mechanism to discuss the trade imbalance. See, this Mahamallapuram summit is the second informal summit between India and China, and such informal summits are significant in foreign relations as they can resolve the existing tensions between the engaging nations. Then we'll discuss the role played by India and China in international institutions. Here the author mentions that as member of several multilateral institutions, both India and China can give shape to the economic destinies of such institutions. For example, reforms are required in World Trade Organization, then in International Monetary Fund and such other multilateral institutions. And these reforms are required to take the world towards inclusive, equitable and sustainable growth of all countries, particularly the developing and the least developed nations. Now, with respect to regional trade issues, the author talks about RCEP, that is Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. And here the suggestion is that the proposed agreement should have a wider ambit, that is, it should have a strong component of trade in services, because India is in a better position in terms of services. Therefore, the RCEP framework should include this component. So, in this context, China has a role to ensure that India's concerns are addressed with respect to RCEP, so that in the future, India may join the framework. In such case, both the nations can grow together in Asia. But if you see in the present draft format, the agreement is appearing as a trade arm of the Belt and Road Initiative of China. And this is the comment made by former Prime Minister of Australia on the present draft of RCEP agreement. Then the author talks about the India-China plus one framework. And we know that under this framework, both India and China are jointly training Afghan diplomats. And this framework is said to be result of the Wuhan informal summit. Therefore, in the future, China and India could explore their potential to work together with other countries on important issues. And they could work on improving the Asian infrastructure and enabling the connectivity in Asia. And this cooperation has to be on the basis of equality and an open and transparent model under the existing Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. That is AIIB. The Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank is a multilateral development bank, and the mission of this bank is to improve social and economic outcomes in Asia. And Beijing is the headquarters of this bank. It began its operations in January 2016, and at present it has grown to about 100 approved members worldwide. The bank is making investments in sustainable infrastructure and other productive sectors in Asia and also beyond Asia. Know that India is a member in this bank, and India has a voting power share of around 7.6% of the total voting power, and China has around 26%. And China is the largest shareholder in this bank, and India is the second largest shareholder in this bank. Then the author mentions that China has to show greater transparency in its various actions, and it has to engage in closer consultations with India when its presence grows in South Asia. Here the presence of China means its involvement with the other countries like Sri Lanka, Pakistan and other South Asian economies. This has assumed significance because there were criticisms on China being non-transparent in the Belt and Road Initiative. And China should respect the territorial integrity of other countries in the Indo-Pacific region. So in this context here, the territorial integrity includes sovereignty over land, water and air space of the respective nations. And we have been seeing in the news about China violating the territorial integrity of nations in Indo-Pacific region in all the dimensions. Now we'll see in areas of convergence, both countries, that is India and China, should have a joint consultative mechanism to protect their interest and the interest of some other developing nations. One such area is in the global energy market, because both the nations are big importers of oil and gas. And such a mutual support system is required to tackle the concerns when there are problems affecting the oil and gas consuming countries. And these are these some of the concerns that have to be addressed between the two large emerging and growing powers of Asia. And we should also remember that for these two countries to rise or other countries in Asia to rise, peace and stability is required at the first place. Therefore, all the Asian countries should aspire together rather than holding back each other. There should be cooperation rather than rivalry. So the author concludes the article by quoting the statement made by the Prime Minister at the second edition of Raisina Dialogue. Know that the second edition of Raisina Dialogue was held in New Delhi in 2017. So in that context, the Prime Minister noted that there is enough room for all Asian countries to prosper together and that the Asia of rivalry will hold us all back. And it is the Asia of cooperation that will shape this century. Therefore, in the context of this editorial article, we saw examples for various aspects of bilateral relations between India and China. Then on security front, we saw about territorial integrity. For example, we have a concern that Belt and Road Initiative of China passing through our territory of Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. Then on China's relations with other countries in South Asia, China has to take India into confidence that such engagements are not strategic or such engagements are not against India. Then on energy front, both countries have to start a joint consultative mechanism to protect the consumer interest. Then at the international level, both countries should bring reforms in the international financial and other institutions. We have also discussed on joint cooperation in developmental work on other countries. That is, we saw about the India-China plus one framework. Then on the trade front, we saw that steps should be taken to address the trade deficit and cheaper import concerns of India from China. Then on political front, we saw about the importance of Mahamallapuram summit's decisions. That one of the decisions made was to address the trade issues. These issues have assumed significance because that India and China has conducted informal summits consistently. That is one in Wuhan, that is in China. Then recently second informal summit at Mahamallapuram in Chennai. So with this information, we have come to the end of analysis of this news article. The displayed practice question will be discussed at the end of the session. Now let us move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article is related to the Bharat Bond Exchange Traded Fund. In our analysis, we'll be discussing the salient features of Bharat Bond ETF and its advantages. The syllabus relevant to the analysis is highlighted here for your reference. Kindly notice that this Bharat Bond Exchange Traded Fund should not be confused with the Bharat 22 ETF. Which is also one type of ETF which was launched in 2017 and managed by ICICI Prudential Mutual Fund. And this Bharat 22 ETF consists of the stocks of, that is 22 stocks of central public sector enterprises, then the public sector banks, then the government owned shares in certain private sector companies. Therefore, it is based on the index, that is Bharat 22 index. And this index is unique blend of shares of key central public sector enterprises, then the public sector banks, and also the government owned shares in private companies like L&T, then Axis Bank and ITC. We can say this Bharat 22 ETF consists of 22 stocks of government shares in certain public sector enterprises, public sector banks, then the government owned shares in certain private sector companies. Now let us come back to the Bharat Bond. Few days back, the Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs, chaired by the Prime Minister, gave its approval for creation and the launch of Bharat Bond Exchange Traded Fund. One of the objectives of this Bharat Bond Exchange Traded Fund is to create an additional source of funding for central public sector undertakings, then the central public sector enterprises, then the central public financial institutions and such other government organizations. Know that this Bharat Bond ETF is the first corporate bond ETF in the country. Now let us understand what is meant by ETF. Exchange traded funds are the funds that are listed and traded on stock exchanges, just like your normal shares. Hence, ETF is a basket of securities that trade on an exchange like Bombay Stock Exchange or national stock exchange, just like your normal stock. Know that the trading value of ETF is based on the net asset value of the underlying stocks that it represents. These ETFs are similar to mutual funds, but with some differences. Know that ETFs can be bought and sold only through the stock exchanges. This Bharat Bond ETF can be called as one type of bond because just like a bond, which is an instrument that represents loan made by an investor to a borrower such as corporate or government organizations. So Bharat Bond ETFs are type of ETF in which the public buys the bonds which are issued. Now let us discuss some of the important features of Bharat Bond. The first and foremost feature of this Bharat Bond ETF is that these bonds are AAA rated bonds. Know that the AAA rated bonds have the highest possible rating that may have assigned to an issuer's bonds by any of the major credit rating agencies. And these AAA rated bonds have high degree of credit worthiness. Now, if you look at the unit size of Bharat Bond, it is just about 1000 rupees. Therefore, this enables the individual investors to invest in this bond. And this will ensure broader investor base as retail investors who are currently not participating in bond markets due to liquidity and accessibility constraints. Now we'll discuss another important feature of Bharat Bond ETF, that is each ETF will have a fixed maturity date. Initially they will be issued in two series, that is with a maturity period of 3 years and maturity period of 10 years. And each series will have a separate index of the same maturity series. And this index will be constructed by an independent index provider, that is the National Stock Exchange. Know that this index helps to measure the value of bond in the market by measuring the performance in the market. And these indices are Nifty Bharat Bond Index of April 2023 and then the Nifty Bharat Bond Index of April 2030. In case of 2023 bonds, the top three issuing companies are the Rural Electrification Corporation Limited, then the Power Finance Corporation and the NABARD. Then in case of 2030 bonds, the top three issuing companies are the National Highways Authority of India, then the Indian Railway Finance Corporation and then Power Grid Corporation. Now we'll see another important feature of Bharat Bonds, that is these Bharat Bonds offer transparency by disclosing the bond details, then the price variations on a daily basis. Therefore, the investors can buy and sell units at the prevailing market prices through their electronic accounts. It is to be noted that Bharat Bond ETF will have one of the cheapest expensive ratio, that is about 0.005%. Here, the expensive ratio or expense ratio is the annual fee that all funds or exchange traded funds charge their shareholders, such as management fees, then the administrative fees and then operating cost. Therefore, lower expensive ratio helps to earn higher returns. Hence, the Bharat Bond offers higher returns for the retail investors. Now, let us discuss some of the advantages offered by the Bharat Bonds to the central public sector enterprises. And this Bharat Bonds would offer central public sector enterprises or the public sector units, or in case of central public financial institutions and other government organizations, as an additional source of investment. It will also expand their investor base through the retail participation, and which can increase demand for their bonds. Therefore, the increase in demand for their bonds would reduce their cost of borrowing over a period of time. So these are some of the advantages with reference to Bharat Bonds. Therefore, with reference to this news article, we have discussed what is meant by exchange traded fund, and then the example for ETF, that is Bharat Bond ETF, then also Bharat 22 ETF. With this information, we have come to the end of analysis of this news article. Now, the displayed practice question will be discussed at the end of this session. Now, let us start our practice prelims question session. Now, look at this question. This question is with reference to the Bharat Bond Exchange Traded Fund, and they have given two statements, and you have to choose the correct statements from the quotes given. Statement 1 says that it is an exchange traded fund with the objective to create an additional source of funding for central public sector undertakings, then central public sector enterprises, then central public financial institutions and other government organizations. This statement is correct because the Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs had recently given its approval for the creation and launch of Bharat Bond Exchange Traded Fund. And its objective is to create an additional source of funding for CPSEs, that is Central Public Sector Enterprises, and for Central Public Sector Undertakings, and also for Central Public Financial Institutions and other government organizations. Now, look at the second statement, which says that Bharat Bond consists of 22 stocks of CPSEs, public sector banks and government-owned shares. Here, the second statement is incorrect because it is related to Bharat 22 ETF but not related to Bharat Bond ETF. Kindly notice that Bharat 22 ETF was launched in 2017 and it is managed by ICICI Prudential Mutual Fund, and this Bharat 22 ETF consists of 22 stocks of CPSEs, that is Central Public Sector Enterprises, then public sector banks and government-owned shares in certain private sector companies such as L&T, Axis Bank. Therefore, the second statement is incorrect. So, for this question, option A, that is one only, is the correct option. Now, consider this question. They have given two statements with reference to Citizenship Act, and you have to choose the correct statements. The first statement says that the Constitution has empowered the Parliament to make any provision with respect to the acquisition and termination of citizenship and all other matters related to citizenship. Then the second statement says that the Citizenship Act of 1955 has been amended only once since its enactment. Now, as per the provisions of Constitution of India, that is as per Article 11, it says that the Parliament shall have the power to make any provision with respect to the acquisition and termination of citizenship and all other matters relating to citizenship. Therefore, this constitutional power was used by the Parliament to enact the Citizenship Act of 1955. So, statement 1 is correct. Now, look at the second statement, which says that Citizenship Act of 1955 has been amended only once since its enactment. Know that since its enactment, that is Citizenship Act of 1955, has been amended about 8 times, that is in 1957, then in 1960, then in 1985, then also in 1986, then in 1992, then in 2003, 2005 and 2015. Therefore, second statement is incorrect. Kindly notice that the proposed Citizenship Amendment Bill of 2019, if passed, would amend the Citizenship Act of 1955 for the 9th time. So, for this question, option A, one only is the correct option. Now, let's take up these questions with reference to Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. Here they have given 5 statements and you have to choose the correct statements. First statement says that the bank can lend to members beyond Asia, and this statement is correct because though the mission of the bank is to improve social and economic outcomes in Asia, the bank can lend to the members beyond Asia. Therefore, first statement is correct. The second statement is also correct because India is one of the founding members of this bank. Then look at this third statement, which says that India is the second largest shareholder in this bank. Then fourth statement says that the bank is dedicated to the promotion of economic and social development in Asia. Then fifth statement says that Beijing is the headquarters of this AIIB. Know that with reference to AIIB, the membership is not restricted to Asian region. For example, even United Kingdom is also member of this AIIB. Then, as a founding member of this AIIB, China is the largest shareholder with about 30.79% of its shares. Then India is the second largest shareholder with around 8.65% of shares. Then the third largest shareholder is Russia. This ranking also applies in terms of voting powers. That is, China's voting power share is about 26.52%. Then the voting power of India is about 7.6%. Then the Russia's voting power is about 5.98%. So all the given statements with reference to Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank are correct. Therefore, for this question, option D, that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, is the correct option. Now look at the reference question, which was appeared in UPSC prelims 2019, that is with reference to AIIB, and they have given three statements and you have to choose the correct statements. So for this question, option A, that is one only, is the correct option. Now consider this question with reference to Lokpal. They have given three statements and you have to choose the statements which are incorrect. Statement one says that it consists of a chairperson and 8 judicial members. Then the second statement says that the chairperson and the members of Lokpal are appointed by the president on the recommendations of a selection committee. Then the third statement says that it has powers to enquire complaints on the allegation of corruption against the incumbent prime minister. Know that Lokpal shall consist of a chairperson and 4 judicial members and 4 non-judicial members, and out of 4 non-judicial members of Lok Sabha, not less than 50% shall be from among the members belonging to the scheduled caste, scheduled tribes and other backward classes including minorities and women. So statement 1 is incorrect. Now look at the second statement, which says that the chairperson and the members of Lokpal are appointed by the president on the recommendations of a selection committee. Kindly notice that the selection committee consists of 5 members including the chairperson, and the prime minister is the chairperson of the selection committee, and other members includes the speaker of Lok Sabha, then the leader of opposition in the Lok Sabha, then the chief justice of India or a judge of a supreme court nominated by the chief justice of India, and also includes one eminent jurist. So second statement is correct because the chairperson and the members of Lokpal are appointed by the president on the recommendations of a selection committee. Now look at the third statement, which says that it has powers to enquire complaints on the allegation of corruption against the incumbent prime minister. Kindly notice that the Lokpal has jurisdiction to enquire into allegations of corruption against many public functionary who is or who has been in the office mentioned in this act, that is Lokpal and Lokayuktas Act of 2013, and it includes the prime minister as well, and who is refers to the incumbent. So we can tell that the incumbent prime minister is included as well. Also notice that the other public functionaries include the minister in the union government, then it includes member of parliament as well as officials of the union government under group A, group B, group C and group D categories, and also chairpersons, members, officers and directors of any board or corporation, society or trust or autonomous body either established by an act of parliament or wholly or partly funded by the union or state government are also covered under the ambit of Lokpal. Also, Lokpal covers any society or trust or body that receives foreign contribution above 10 lakh rupees. So, third statement is also correct statement. But for this question, you have to choose the statements which are incorrect. So, option A, one only, is the correct option for this question. With this, we have come to the end of analysis of today's news articles. If you like the video, please do like, comment, share and subscribe Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates on civil services exam preparation. Thank you.